I wrote this book because I believe that the Underground Railroad is the most unappreciated and most important movement in American history, a movement that I believed helped bring on the Civil War and end slavery. The two things that I start my talk with is that the Underground Railroad was the most significant civil disobedience movement this country has ever seen, and it was the first, and as far as I know, the only movement that was biracial right from the beginning and was led by African Americans. I don't think we've had anything like that in our history before or since. The other reason is because I'm an advocate of African American history, and I believe African American history needs to be fitted in. And since I'm a historian, I'm just going to talk, and every time we teach sections of American history, when you're a teacher, and you teach the American Revolution, and you teach the Move West, African American history plays a significant role in all of these movements. Let me introduce myself. I'm Evelyn Milstein, and tonight I'm going to be talking about my book, The Underground Railroad, a movement that changed America. I have had a passion for African American history since I was 15 years old. I got introduced to African American history by a fabulous woman, Irma Henderson, who many of you will remember as one of the great chairmen of Detroit City Council. Presidents, I mean. let me tell you why I was compelled to write my first book at age 85. I have never in my life written a book before. This is my first book. I had been a professional medical librarian most of my life, and when I retired in 1983, I decided to produce actually my first love, which was to work in a public library as a reference librarian and just walk. After dealing with doctors and medical issues, this was such a lovely, peaceful, as everybody laughs. And I did that for 20 years as a part-time librarian. I started out by doing some substitute librarianship just because I didn't know anything. And this is one of the libraries that allowed me to be a substitute librarian for about a year. And then I went to work as a part-time librarian at the East Point Memorial Library. And I really loved doing it. Patrons, as opposed to the medical world, is so warm and refreshing. And I especially loved the fact that I was able to introduce lots and lots of parents, teachers, students to what African American history was all about. And because I knew so much about it, I got funneled. Every time I sat at the reference desk, I got funneled all the questions, and if I wasn't there, I would get written notes, please answer this question so we can, and I absolutely loved it. And one of my favorite subjects within African American history was the Underground Railroad. And so I began to just read everything I could find on the Underground Railroad. And as I began to read, I felt that there was something missing. I felt there was just like a hole in the story. There were just wonderful stories about individual rescues, but nothing about the railroad, just about the rescues. I got more and more upset over the fact that there were pieces missing, that the story didn't seem to be a whole story. And then I began to see what was missing, which was the story of the organized Underground Railroad. Everybody talks about the railroad as if it wasn't organized, except for a few little houses that people hid in. I had a lot of writer friends, and I said to them, oh, please, you have to write a new book on the Underground Railroad. I'll do all the research, you just do the writing. And they just looked at me and laughed. They said, you have to write the book. It's it's your story, you've got to write it. And I said, but I'm not a writer. I've never written a thing in my life besides a few reports. And they said, well, then you have to learn how to write because you're the only one who can tell the story. And they agreed to help me. And so I had a lot of writer friends who operated like editors and proofreaders and just everything one needs if you're going to learn how to write. Took me 14 years to write this book. Now, the first question that everybody asks is, why is your book different? There's so many, if you go in and look in a catalog and say Underground Railroad, pages come out. But as I said, I felt that there was something different that I had to say. And these are the two things that I believe make my book different than other books on the Underground Railroad. One is that the Underground Railroad was the greatest civil disobedience movement in the history of America. There is no other movement that even comes close. And civil disobedience, don't forget, doesn't just mean going out to demonstrate. It means refusing to obey a law and risking some kind of punishment. That's civil disobedience. And anyone involved in the Underground Railroad was operating under civil disobedience because of the two fugitive slave laws. One that's in the Constitution and passed by the first Congress, which says fugitive slaves basically are property. And if you help, you're in effect stealing property or helping to steal property. So anyone engaged in any form of the Underground Railroad is by definition engaging in civil disobedience. The second and even more interesting to me was the fact that the Underground Railroad was the first and maybe the only biracial movement in American history that was led by African Americans, but always from the beginning of the railroad, was biracial. It wasn't just a black movement, it wasn't just a white movement. It was a biracial movement where people, black and white people, cooperated from the beginning. But the more you study it, the more you realize that I'm not saying them all, but most of the leaders of this movement were African Americans. Tonight I'm going to talk about what I believe are the two most significant aspects of the Underground Railroad that have not been studied. The first is the South. If you read or take a class or something about the Underground Railroad, they always start with the North. You know, they have all these safe houses and, you know, all these noble people doing things. But nobody talks about the South, and when they do, they talk about the South as if it was an individual or maybe a small group of individuals who somehow got out of the South, who knows how. My contention is that the Underground Railroad was as tightly organized in the South as it was in the North. And let me explain, and that's what I passed out to you because I think that's the most startling, is the story of the Underground Railroad in the South. First of all, you have to picture the South. The South was like a police state. There were government officials roaming around. There were patrollers. There were slave hunters. And if you were caught trying to escape or caught by one of these operations without a written pass from your owner, your punishment was very brutal. Severe beatings, brandings, physical mutilations. And it was not uncommon that a chronic runaway would just be murdered. Yet year after year, slaves still chose freedom. And the figures that are given about the escape of fugitive slaves over the period of, and I'm just using Revolutionary War in this talk, the beginning of the Civil War, because after the Civil War you couldn't even count, but is like 150,000 slaves managed to escape from the South. Now, if that's not an incredible story, I don't know what is. Now, how did they do it? It's certainly that a few slaves escaped all on their own and maybe used people that they knew, family or friends. But you could not have that figure without an organized way of helping people escape. I think that the secret weapon of the Southern Underground Railroad is a class of men, black seamen. Now, let me explain what I mean. Before America had a national railroad system, there was only one way to get a crop, and the railroads really didn't show up till about 1850 in terms of moving anything. They used, the only way they could get them to market was by boat. The South was blessed by a honeycomb of rivers that flowed from the mountains down to the seaports. And most southern plantations, the big ones, were built right on the banks of these rivers. Hundreds of small vessels traveled constantly between plantation and town, and many of them from plantation all the way to a seaport. These boats of various kinds were still not very big, relatively speaking. They only held, in terms of people operating them, one or two people. These black seamen were unsupervised for days, weeks, sometimes even longer. Nobody else in the South, I didn't find any records of white river seamen. Nobody could take their place. Everybody in the South knew that they were transporting fugitives, or some of them were, I mean. But they couldn't do anything about it because they wouldn't be able to sell their cotton, they wouldn't be able to sell their tobacco. And these were extremely skilled professionals. They passed their knowledge down father to son or family members. So many of them, we don't know how many because they didn't have a membership card. So many of them. We really know their activities because during the Civil War they just blossomed and they were transporting everybody, including Union soldiers. When fugitives arrived at a port city, they might be passed from one river man to another, but when they got to the port city, they had to be taken from the small boat onto the dock, into the port city to be hidden until they could find a vessel that would take them north. And because also the docks were teeming with African Americans who are also part of the Underground Railroad and a few white women, William Still, who was the chief writer that taught everybody who wanted to know how the Underground Railroad wrote it. He was the head of the Underground Railroad in Philadelphia, and he recorded everything in a marvelous book that he just called The Underground Railroad. And he talks about white market women who helped. There were Quakers who helped get fugitive slaves from the port city on to the boats, to the ships, I mean, that went north. Many of them are still nameless. We don't know who they are. He still didn't know who he was, who this white woman was, for example. He just knows her as a market woman who operated for 20 years. So when a ship got ready to go north, they had to be clean. They needed to be supplied. Who was doing all that? Wharf workers, laundry women, people who supplied food, people, mechanics. In the sort of way in which people moved up and down, and who could figure out, there just weren't, it wasn't easy enough to figure out who was who, they would smuggle, and they did a terrific job of smuggling people onto the ships. There were seamen, mostly black, but a few white, who would hide onto the boats, into secret places on the boats, and then help get them off when they reached a northern port. Now, one of my favorite stories about the South, because not only did we have sailors who helped, but there were sea captains, northern sea captains, who they were totally opposed to slavery. They would come down, there were four of them that William still talks about, travel down, fill up whatever hiding places they had, and they were there with the connivance of the captains who transported them north. And my guess is the same thing went on south. We just don't have any record of it because we don't have a William Still. But if you lived in Georgia or South Carolina, it was even easier to get to the Bahamas than it was to get to Boston. You know, especially if you're using sea captains, and they were going both ways. Let me tell you the story of my favorite, most charming sea captain. His name was Captain Flowers, and William Still loved to tell stories about him. And one of the stories that he tells about Captain Fountain was that one day, the mayor of Norfolk, Virginia, everybody knew that Fountains was doing something. Slaves were escaping with his help, but they could never were able to prove it. He marched on with a posse onto Fountain's boat, and he said, "We're going to find your secret hiding place." And Fountains, who was a scoundrel, a charming scoundrel if there ever was one, said, "Oh, let me help you." Picks up an axe, and he says, "Where shall I start?" Well, this already made the mayor slightly nervous. Then Fountains begin to wave his axe around. "Shall I hit the deck here? Wham, wham. Or how about up here? Wham." The mayor took one look at what he thought was a maniacal and said, marched his posse right off the ship. Fountains had 20 fugitive slaves hidden in his ship. When he delivered his group of fugitives to William Still, that's when he told William Still the story, and that's how we know what happened. And that is just a number of stories about the Underground Railroad in the South, except for one story, which I think is really important to tell you, and that's about the Seminole Indians. Now, when you talk about the Underground Railroad in the South, I've never heard anyone mention the Seminole Indians, and yet they were the most important destination of slaves who wished to escape slavery, who were living in the Carolinas, Georgia, and even North Florida. Because if a fugitive slave escaped to Seminole lands, which were South Florida, they were already free. They were part of society. They were welcomed into society. What we now label Black Seminoles, I'm not sure what they were called within the Seminole tribes, they were welcomed. They were given their own villages. They were part of the Seminole Nation. They elected their own chiefs, who were part of the Seminole Tribal Council. Now, and what's more, everybody in the South knew it, and that's one of the reasons that when Andrew Jackson issued that Indian Removal Act, which is one of the shameful parts of American history, where he ordered every single Indian tribe in the South to be removed to Oklahoma. He included the Seminoles, even though the land that they were living on had absolutely no value to Southern planters. The North had, the North Florida had value, that had plantations. The South was nothing but swamp. But they insisted that these Seminoles be removed. Why? Because so many of their slaves were fleeing to the Seminole Nation. So they were included in this order. This was an issue that tore apart the Seminole Nation. Because the Seminole Nation was both black and white. In the Seminole councils, there was this dialogue back and forth. You know, we fought the Americans when they were conquering North Florida and we lost every battle. How can we fight them now? We know this is terrible, but how can we fight them back? We have no way to do it. And then others would stand up and say, but these are our brothers and sisters. What can we do? Because in this removal, I forgot to mention it, in this particular removal, Indian Seminoles were going to go west to Oklahoma. Black Seminoles were going directly to the auction block. Abraham, who was chief of the Black Seminoles, he was like the principal chief of the Black Seminoles, told the council that he had a plan. He agreed that they could never defeat the American army in direct battle. But he said, we have something. We have the swamps. And his plan was one of the original guerrilla warfares. We attack, and then we retreat into the swamp, and we attack. And they can't, because we know the swamps. They don't. And they boast. You look on their website. We're the only Indian nation that was never defeated by the United States. And part of that reason were Black Seminoles, because there are some terrific fighters among the Black Seminoles. Now, civil disobedience is the second part of my talk. And in order to understand the civil disobedience movement and what an impact it had, you have to understand what was happening in 1850. All of a sudden, the issue was clearly divided. The North practically unanimously said no slavery in these new territories. The South said, we have every right to take our slaves any place we want to, especially since most of these territories were below the Mason-Dixon line. And that had been an old treaty. And this went on for almost a year. The United States House of Representatives, in that year, did not pass one single piece of legislation. All they did was fight about this. Finally, they got Henry Clay, who was in American history noted as the great negotiator. And this is what he tried to do. He tried to find out the thing that each side wanted more than anything else, and then try to negotiate other things. This is the most complicated issue, but the most important parts of this issue are, was California going to come in as a free or a slave state? They had just discovered gold in California. Now, in some of the history books I read, I read something that said, well, the slaveholders weren't interested in gold mines because they couldn't do anything with gold mines, which made me burst out laughing, because all of Spain, all in South America, were using slaves of all kinds, and they were getting rich over it. And this was not news to slaveholders in the South. They wanted California. The North equally wanted free men to be able to go to California and mine gold, and this went on and on and on, until Henry Clay found something that was even more important to slaveholders than getting rich on gold, and that was to defeat the Underground Railroad. Now, this immediately tells you that the Underground Railroad was having a terrible impact on the South. That runaway slaves was not a minor issue, as is sometimes repeated in history books. Would you give up gold for a few handful of people that were running away? Well, I wouldn't. Instead of, they agreed to allow California to come in as a free state in exchange for the most radically oppressive fugitive slave law that I've ever seen anyplace. Not only was anybody involved in the Underground Railroad now really subject to mostly jail or other terrible things, but there was a new clause which said that if you were an innocent bystander and a posse came by, or even a slave hunter came by and said, help me catch that slave, or help me, usually it's a mob scene, you're going to be part of this slave hunting operation. And if you're not, you're also in going to be facing a jail sentence. And when I say that they were serious about this, in Pennsylvania, there was a case of two Quakers, they didn't believe in violence with anything, who were standing in front of one of my favorite heroes, William Parker, who was resisting a slaveholder and a posse, and in his house were a group of fugitive slaves. He was actually a fugitive slave too. And they were fighting it out. And these two Quakers were standing in front of the house begging both sides to stop fighting. And they were arrested. And the charge for not helping capture William Parker and his friends, the charge that the government issued against them was treason. Treason. Now that shows you the impact that some of this stuff is having that you don't hear about. I think that took the jury 15 minutes to send them home. The Fugitive Slave Law created, I had talked about civil disobedience before, and it was an important movement. It probably was sort of like some of the demonstrations to get the Vietnam War or other things. The minute that Northerners realized what in the world this fugitive slave law was, that's when the civil disobedience movement turned into something we've never seen before. And what I'm going to do is give you a couple of examples. I mean, in so many of the northern states, Michigan, I could do a whole talk on Michigan. Michigan had one of the most glorious examples of resistance. Detroit was the center of the Underground Railroad. Western Michigan had all kinds of activity. But I'm just going to give you a few that resonated nationally. The first one, and slaveholders were particularly interested in Boston. As far as they're concerned, Boston was the hub of the abolitionist movement. So the Fugitive Slave Law takes effect 1851 February. Shadrach Minkins was a fugitive slave. He was arrested. And the minute the news got out, and they had already been organized to do something, Lewis Hayden, who led a mob into the courtroom, rescued Minkins, and he was soon on his way. It just took, boom, because they were organized, and he was on his way to Canada. Lewis Hayden, of course, was arrested. He had led the movement to rescue Minkins. He was arrested. He didn't exactly do it in the dark. Everybody saw him. He was put on trial, and the jury refused to convict. Didn't matter what the testimony was, the Boston jury refused to convict him. He just left. It infuriated the South. And Boston was divided into two kinds of groups. They were the cotton Bostonians, their livelihood depended on cotton, and then there was what I call everybody else, who wasn't involved in the cotton trade. But the cotton Bostonians were the leaders of the community, at least they had been. And they immediately told Southern planters, who were their clients, that they were going to make sure that the fugitive slave law was enforced in Boston. So just a few months later, another fugitive was captured. His name was Thomas Sims. And this time, the entire law enforcement community and leadership was determined that Sims was going to go back. He was a Georgian slave. The next morning, after Sims was captured, the citizens of Boston woke up to the astonishing sight of their courthouse ringed in steel chains while 500 policemen patrolled all of the streets surrounding the building. Even the judges, this is a couple of descriptions of these reverend elderly judges having to crawl under the chains in order to get to their own courtrooms. Sims, of course, was immediately declared a fugitive and was ordered to be returned to Savannah. The federal officials were so afraid that he might get rescued that they sent Sims back down to the wharf at 3 o'clock in the morning, guarded by all these people. And then the Boston newspaper, the Commonwealth, gloated that Boston is redeemed. The fugitive slave law has been in force. Some of the slaveholders wondered about the cost of this enforcement. It had taken $20,000 to send one fugitive slave. And $20,000 would be a lot of money today. You can imagine what it was like in 1850. Now, Syracuse, New York was a different story. There were no cotton mill owners or anything there. They all hated the fugitive slave law. The minute they heard what the fugitive slave law really was, the mayor of Syracuse organized a city vigilance committee. And most vigilance committees all over the country were like the public faces of the private Underground Railroad. Everybody knew what they were, they just couldn't catch them. Publicly, they were just supposed to be protecting freedmen, but this time he just said, we're just protecting every fugitive. This vigilance committee's job is to protect every fugitive living in Syracuse, and there were plenty. One fugitive was caught. His name was Jerry McHenry. The vigilance committee sprang into action immediately. An agreed-upon signal was that all the church bells would ring, and they would gather and plan the rescue, which they did. And the rescue, they burst Jerry out of jail. When they got him down the stairs, and they were pursued by a bunch of federal marshals, they put him in a carriage with a white horse. And standing all the way around there were many carriages with white horses. And as The marshals were coming down the stairs. White horses were in every direction. And I thought the most charming thing was that the city of Syracuse celebrated what they called the Jerry Rescue, and there's even a statue in Syracuse commemorating. They celebrated that as a city holiday every year until the end of the Civil War. Now that shows you the depth of the kinds of resistance that nobody ever talks about. I mean, the next and even more interesting resistance was when Joshua Glover, who lived in Wisconsin, was captured. 5,000 people immediately protested outside the jail, and it wasn't long before he was rescued. When the rescuers were arrested under the fugitive slave law, and this time they were tried by a federal jury because they didn't trust any state juries. Federal jury said, yeah, they obviously wasn't exactly a secret that they had been part of the rescue team, probably the leaders of the rescue team. The Wisconsin State Supreme Court ordered that these men be released, and this is the reason. The fugitive slave law is unconstitutional. When in the history of this country has a state Supreme Court ruled that a federal law is unconstitutional? It's never happened before, and it's never happened since. But this is the level of resistance that I believe makes this civil disobedience different than anything else we've seen. And just to finish the story of resistance, because I love, it's back in Boston, because boy, they were determined to do something. And I don't know if any of you have heard about Anthony Burns, but he's one of the most famous fugitives only because he was captured, and this was 1854, and they were getting ready to send him back. And this is what Boston looked like. You would think that we were back during the Tea Party days. The government was so determined to send him back. 150 militiamen were ordered to encircle the courthouse and down the street. They also ordered, I don't know how many army men from different posts in different states bordering Boston, so that the entire city was filled with armed forces. They actually wheeled an artillery gun into the center of Boston Square. When Burns marched down the street, if anybody's been to Boston, you know it's like a 15-minute walk from the courthouse to the harbor, 15, 20 minutes. When he was marched down the street, this is what he saw. Every business was closed. Their windows were draped in black. A coffin was lowered along Main Street, wrapped in black. The crowd was so dense, it took 3 hours to clear a path to get him to what is a 15, 20 minute walk to a federal ship that was waiting. 50,000 people followed him and shouted at the officials, shame, shame, shame. And Amos Lawrence, who was one of the richest men in Boston, he had been a textile magnate, he had been one of the people supporting the fugitive slave law, talked about this sentence, and he said, "We went to bed, old-fashioned, conservative, compromise Union Whigs, and waked up stark, mad abolitionists." Anthony Burns was the last fugitive ever taken from Boston. They just never came into Boston again. Those are some of the examples why the South, I mean, it wasn't the only reason for the Civil War, but it certainly convinced Southerners, slaveholders, that the North was against them. The North was against slavery. I can't talk about the Civil War because that would take another hour. Of all the things, the Underground Railroad was such a key operation, and I'm not talking about soldiers. I'm just talking about what the Underground Railroad did for the Union. I have three chapters in my book about that, but there is something that people do not know, and that is the South's response to what was happening, to what their slaves were doing, convincing them that they were not going to be their supporters, but they were going to be, they were a fifth column that they could not control in the Confederacy. In January 1865, the Confederate government was facing a crisis. Their army, because of increasing casualties, mass desertions, was now only one-fourth the size of the Union Army. And there was no place that they could find fresh troops. A handful of Confederate leaders began thinking the unthinkable. They might have to abolish slavery in order to save the Confederacy. Jefferson Davis had just proposed to enlist some 40,000 slaves in the Confederate Army. The president knew that the only way these men would fight is that they were offered freedom for themselves and their families. The outcry in the South was instantaneous and outraged. It was to protect slavery that we formed the Confederacy, and there's really no doubt about why they formed the Confederacy. Newspapers throughout the South were just angry and frustrated, Jefferson Davis was forced to ask Robert E. Lee to defend his position. Robert E. Lee told Southerners that it was necessary to save the Confederacy by recruiting some of these African Americans. And on March 4th, 1865, the Confederacy did pass a bill authorizing the recruitment of these 40,000. Now, I believe that this is so significant and not taught. Here's the South confessing that they started out in life saying, well, the reason they're slaves is because they're just not capable of, you know. And now they're begging their slaves to save the Confederacy. That's the reason, this is one of the reasons that I felt compelled to write this book. So that's my story. When I was about 15 years old, I met Irm Henderson, who later on, she was a young, beautiful woman then, ended up in president of the Detroit City Council. And she and a bunch of her friends, we were all in a civil rights type of organization right after World War II. And she introduced me to Black history because I came in one day to the office and started raving about this wonderful book called Gone with the Wind. to this day, I can hear the shock. And so they decided they would introduce me to Black history so I would understand why they were so shocked about Gone with the Wind. And I was a history nut anyway. And I began reading and talking to them, and they all knew so much about Black history that starting with that, I just started reading everything I could get my hands on.